Thank you, SwitchPoint, for inviting me to address this incredible conference. This is actually my first time in Sacsapaha. Is that how it's said? It's actually my first time in North Carolina, if you can believe that. Thank you. I did come here. I took a Greyhound once from Tampa to New York, and I guess I passed through here, but that doesn't count. And that was a crazy experience also. So today I'll be talking about how I became an emoji data scientist. And it's something a lot of people want to know about, because when they find out I'm an emoji data scientist, they're like, what is that? And if they're my parents, they want to cry that I didn't become a doctor. No, I'm kidding. But the story of how I became an emoji data scientist is kind of the story of how I went from this. This is me growing up as a nice young boy in Brooklyn, New York, to this. This is me all emojied out, speaking at the world's first ever emoji conference in San Francisco a few years ago. And I think my journey of how I went from that nice young boy to an emoji data scientist is really a journey of how I learned that the skills and abilities I had honed for so many years as a data scientist, I could use those abilities to answer questions, not just questions that, you know, my boss gave me or my graduate program gave me, but questions I was genuinely curious about and passionate about. And one of those questions was emojis and what they mean. I think I also got very lucky. I was lucky because most data scientists thought emojis were silly. It's okay if some of you think they are. After this talk, you'll realize emojis are actually pretty exciting. And most of the people who were fascinated by emojis didn't know data science. So I was very lucky to be at this intersection of someone who knew data science and also loved emojis. The journey of how I became an emoji data scientist, I think we have to go a little back and start with how I got into data science, how I got into statistics. I've never done this before, so this is taking a leap, quoting myself in a talk, but this is the past me. I know it's important to cite sources, but this was my my statement of purpose for graduate school, and I put a lot of work in this statement of purpose, and I'm very proud of it. I wish I could publish it somewhere. And one of the lines I really like in this statement was, soon data sets, large, unseemly, raw collections of numbers began to tell me their stories. Whether these stories concern demographics, human physiology, or the economy, they shed light on our understanding of the world. I saw firsthand how the language of statistics worked and the immense power it held. Hamdan Azar, 2008. And, you know, I was really into statistics. I was really into data science. I got into graduate school, many graduate schools, thank God. And I ended up at the University of Michigan, go blue. At the University of Michigan, oh, nice. This is a good representation. At the University of Michigan School of Public Health. So yeah, this is kind of linked to what we're talking about here. And I got my master's in biostatistics. While I was there, you know, I worked on a study of neuroimaging and how the brain processes the placebo effect. This is a fancy brain imaging picture, because I'm in the company of so many incredible doctors and researchers, so I can feel like I'm similar to you guys. And you know, I did a lot of other things. I worked as a national statistician on Ron Paul's campaign. Ron Paul ran for president in 2012, and this is me in our New Hampshire office. And you know, the first things we did is we had a board called Statistics Central, so everyone who walked by, they could see all our stats. Again, these were very early days for data and politics, before all of these, lots of things happened after that, but back then, if someone on a campaign knew Excel, they were chief statistician. So when I walked in with a master's in biostatistics, I was basically campaign manager. No, I'm kidding. So after that, I worked at Facebook, a social networking site. I worked there for a few years as a data scientist working on ads research. Again, back in the old days, I had to explain to everyone what ads research was. Now everyone knows what ads research is. We study how advertising works, how effective it is, and how it can motivate people to change their behavior for good ways or bad ways. And one day, I said, I've worked at a big company for a while. I want to do something different. What should I do? So I quit my job, and I kind of really dug into myself. And I knew I really liked working with data. I kind of liked politics. And I wanted to do something that no one else was doing. I kind of had this desire to be different. So one day, I'm scrolling through my newsfeed, and Brexit has just happened. And I see this article in Quartz. It's called The World's Reaction to Brexit in Emoji. Now, I'm very excited when I see this, because I've always thought about this, because I think emojis can be used as a form of sentiment analysis to see how are people feeling about current events that are happening in the world. So I go to read the article. This is not an excerpt from the article. This is the entire article. The article is just a list of politicians and an emoji representing how they felt about Brexit. And as we would say in graduate school, there is no data in this article. And it was kind of a joke. This was my reaction to this article in emoji. And I realized, you know, I can do this. I can actually do this. I can do what they purported to do. So I locked myself in my room for 3 days. I engaged in a one-man hackathon, 72 hours. And I learned how to download tweets using R. I learned how to extract the emojis from those tweets. Apparently, emoji encoding is a very, very complicated and messy topic. It took me 72 hours to figure it out. And at the end of those 72 hours, I'd published an article in Vice called "Here Are the Most Popular Emojis from the Brexit Reaction." And this was really my first time doing data storytelling of this nature, and it was kind of exhilarating. Because working at a big company or working in academia, we're not used to this quick turnaround. When we do work, it's usually for a small audience, our boss and our boss's boss, if we're lucky. But here, I just wrote an article, and all of a sudden, people on the internet were talking about it. They were tweeting at me about it. It was exciting. And so what did we find? We found that people use emojis to express their genuine emotional reactions to Brexit. We find emojis both on the positive side, the clapping hands, the thumbs up. We also find emojis on the negative side, the sad face, the crying face. Basically, if people thought that emojis are trivial and people are just choosing them at random to waste their time, that doesn't seem to be what's happening over here. People are actually expressing their emotional sentiments using emojis. We also found that the emojis people used correlate with the hashtags they were using. So people who were sad about Brexit, who were using the sad emojis, were more likely to be using the hashtags "vote remain" and "not my vote." People who were happy about Brexit using the party hat emoji were using the hashtag "vote leave," suggesting that there could be some signal in emoji data that can help us understand the world around us. My next project was not politics. It did involve a very, very, very contentious issue. I can see some people laughing in the background. It was the dispute between Kanye West and Taylor Swift. So by a show of hands, who here is familiar with this dispute? Wow, that's a lot more hands than I was expecting. You guys rock. When I talk about this to high school students, they literally start jumping up and down because they want to tell me about the dispute, and they all have different interpretations. Last month, I spoke at a university in Morocco to data science master's students. And I thought, like, I was just gonna skip over the slide. And they literally started screaming out in Arabic, English, French, "This is what happened, Kanye Taylor, and then Justin Bieber said this, and then this is," it was crazy. Unfortunately, I don't have time to explain the dispute, but lots of people know what happened and they can fill you in. Basically, what I did is I looked at, while this dispute is happening, what are the emojis people are using to talk about Taylor and Kanye? And what we see right off the bat is that, yes, the emojis are different. Taylor gets the heart and the hard eyes. Kanye gets the fire. But we also see the snake emoji. And this is the first time the snake emoji had turned up in one of my analyses. So this was the world's first documented instance of snake bombing, when millions of people went to Taylor Swift's profile and left comments of the snake emoji. Instagram actually banned the snake emoji for 72 hours because they said it was cyberbullying. What was happening is that Kanye's fans were saying Taylor was a snake. She was disloyal, she was ungrateful, because Kanye had built up her career, and they just went and started leaving snake emojis on poor Taylor's profile. This is another way of visualizing the same data, where on the left we see emojis that are more commonly used in tweets mentioning Taylor, and on the right we see emojis more commonly used with Kanye. Again, you see the snake does not belong there. And we'll pass over this. Let's turn to something a little more serious. Election night, 2016, a very emotional night for many people. And many statisticians on election night were gathering data on who was voting and how the results were coming out. I, also a statistician, was looking at emoji data and what people were tweeting about. And this is looking at tweets in the 3 hours after the results started being announced, after midnight Eastern time. And what you see, what I find very informative about this visualization, is that one image seems to encapsulate the emotional state of a whole country. You see on the left, people are using emojis of heartbreak and the heart and praying and crying in tweets mentioning Hillary Clinton. And Donald Trump's emojis seem to fall into two categories. Either you have the party hat and the celebratory emoji and the thumbs up, or you also have the rolling eyes, the angry face, the thinking face, the middle finger, which also has never shown up before in an analysis. And I think this really captures how powerful these, you know, little images, digital images are, and how people are using them to talk about really meaningful topics. This is one tweet that I find incredibly poignant. Again, a lot of people think emojis are silly, but people, millions, maybe billions of people are using them regularly to talk about very serious topics. And this is the thinking face emoji, one of the most popular emojis. And the tweet is, how can I go to work in the morning knowing the people I work with voted for Trump? Thinking face emoji, I just can't. So emojis are an important part of many people's language and discourse. And we can learn a lot of stuff from it. I'll briefly touch on one last analysis I did. So this is when the Donald Trump's travel ban was first announced, the first version of it, or the Muslim ban. And what happened is my sister worked for the city of New York, and all these lawyers were rushing to the airports because all these people were coming in and there were detentions happening. So she's like, I'm going to JFK, do you want to come with me? I'm like, okay, sure. It's next to our house. So we go to JFK, there's lawyers at a table, you know, on their laptops, and she's like sitting with them. And I go up and I say, hey guys, I'm an emoji data scientist, and I also watch Law and Order, like, put me to work. How can I help you guys? There are people getting turned away from this country. Like, I can do something. And they had no idea what to make of me. So I went back home, and I did what I do. I looked at the emojis people were using to talk about the situation. So I looked at four of the most popular hashtags, no ban, no wall, not the resistance, not my president. And very interestingly, we find that the emojis people were using were the heart emoji, the fist emoji, which is the emoji of resistance, and also the American flag. I think there was a narrative that a lot of these protests were anti-American, but if you look at the emojis people were using, you find a lot of them are tweeting the American flag, saying this does not represent our country's values, tweeting the heart emoji, saying we're a country built on love for all people. And again, emojis really shedding light on an important cultural topic. So what I'd like to leave you with is that while emojis might seem silly and trivial, people are using them to convey real and authentic emotions. In fact, I think when we live in an era when people fear technology is increasingly being used to surveil us and manipulate us and cause harmful effects in society, emojis are also a form of technology, and people are using them to express their emotions, to connect with each other, and to find commonality. Finally, I'm a data scientist, so I have to give the last plug. Emojis are data, and data science can help us understand them. That's why you guys need me. But also to tell you stories. And I think emojis are very interesting. I think there are lots of possible applications to public health and society at large. I'll be having a micro lab on that this afternoon. And all of this work is open source. Now that I work, you know, not at a big company, I'm happy to do this. So you can find a tutorial on emoji data science in R at prismoji.com. And thank you to SwitchPoint for having me. And it's been a pleasure.